Good morning, Northside family. We are Juana Renee Fulton, and we miss you guys terribly. But however, we're so excited that we're able to worship with you via technology. So what we would like to do is say a quick prayer with you, and then let's begin our worship time together. Juan?
Okay, bow with us, please. Pray, Lord, that you be with us this day. Thank you for all your goodness. Thank you for the being able to come together as a family and to worship you through this technology. Pray now, Lord, you just be with Brother Van. Just lead God and direct him and give him the words to say during the sermon. Pray now that you also just be with our country, be with our leaders, and just lead God and direct them. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Welcome to week three of online worship. I'm Keith Warren, executive pastor. This is Sam Nobles, our teaching pastor. I want to thank you and your family for joining us today. It's Palm Sunday. Tell us about Palm Sunday.
Palm Sunday is when we celebrate the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem for the last week of his life before his death and resurrection.
Yes, so it's an important week in our faith, important message for the church. I want to thank you for being part of that. Remember that you're important to us. If you have a need, we are in the office. You can call. You can reach out to us on social media. You can visit our website. You can use the church app. I want to thank you for giving during this time. So many of you have mailed in an offering, visit our online giving. We actually made budget last week, which is an exciting thing for us. So thank you for that.
Well, thanks again for joining. Let's get to the service.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty? So heaven is real, and death is a lie. I want to hear voices of angels above, singing as one, hallelujah. Holy, holy, God Almighty, the great I am.
Great. times like this, we need to trust in the great I am. And Father, you are greatly to be praised. And we thank you so much for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for our sins. And it's because of his death, his burial, his resurrection, that if we truly believe in that gospel story, that miracle, then the chains that surround us would fall to the ground. And because of your amazing grace, God, we praise you today. And we ask in the name of Jesus that as we trust in you, as we sing to you, the chains in our life would all fall away. And we sing of your amazing grace this morning. In his name, amen.
Lost, but now. I want you to join me this morning as we lift up some needs in prayer and, of course, the things that are going on around our nation and around the world with the coronavirus. We lost someone very special this week. Ron Kaysen was a greeter at one of our doors. He was a man who was faithful to this church and was so completely committed to the fellowship. A loving and sensitive man who passed away unexpectedly from a surgery that follow-up. But I want you to pray for Gene and the family. This man was a treasure in my life. John Coleman lost his mother. And also we lost Ronnie Corder, one of our local lawmen, one of our sheriff's deputies. And we're certainly going to be lifting up those families as well. But this prayer time this morning, I want you to pray that God would allow you to see yourself in the way that this sermon would approach you. Don't be thinking of it as far as textual interpretation, or be thinking of it in terms of what it might mean to others, but what it would say, because I believe God has a word for you. Whatever your age, wherever you are, quiet the children, gather the family, we open our hands, we open our hearts. Lord God, in the midst of this season, we find ourselves troubled by all of the events. We find ourselves having to find new ways to entertain ourselves, new ways to take care of our children. In the midst of the shortages, though, Lord, you are our fullness. In the midst of this vacuum, you fill us with your spirit and you give us a confident spirit that you are at work against the coronavirus. You're at work against all the forces that would come against us. God, I do pray for these families that grieve today. Because next week is Easter, I know that their hope is high. Because Jesus Christ came to set us free from all pain and death. Lord, today, I pray that in the midst of these homes, in the midst of the places where people are watching, there would be a real sense of your presence. That they might know that you are there with them, just as you would be here with us in this worship center. Guide us in this day. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Well, what great messages Sam has shared over the past couple of weeks about the miracle worker. Jesus Christ, the one who is the miracle worker over sickness and pain and the miracle worker over nature. Today, we're going to come to a very interesting passage. Now, I do pray that you will listen closely and attentive so that you don't get focused on the wrong thing. This is a passage about Jesus' power over all spiritual forces. Now I'm going to read to you from Matthew chapter 8. And if you have a Bible, you might want to turn there and follow along as I read this passage. It's from Matthew 8, verses 28 through 34. This has to do with Jesus' power over spiritual forces. Keep that in mind. When he came to the other side of the country into the Gadarenes, two men who were demon-possessed met him as they were coming out of the tombs. They were so extremely violent that one could not pass that way. And they cried out saying, "What business do we have with each other, Son of God? Have you come here to torment us before the time?" Now there was a herd of many swine feeding at a distance from them. The demons began to entreat him, saying, "If you're going to cast us out, send us into the herd of swine." And he said to them, "Go." And they came out and went into the swine, and the whole herd rushed down the steep bank into the sea and perished in the waters. The herdsmen ran away and went into the city and reported everything, including what had happened to the demoniacs. And behold, the whole city came out to meet Jesus. And when they saw him, they implored him to leave their region. What a story. Now, I want to share with you how people can get things and misinterpret them. You see, a pastor loves to do children's time. It's a great time to be able to get with the children. And a pastor was doing that. And as he began to do that, he sat at a table and he sat three glasses out there. And then he had a little can of worms. The first glass had alcohol in it. The second glass was covered up and had smoke in it, cigarette smoke and cigar smoke, and was covered. The third glass had chocolate. He took a worm and dropped it into the alcohol. He took a worm and dropped it into the smoke and recovered. He took another worm and put it down in the chocolate. And then they sat for a moment and watched. And the three worms died. He asked a question of the children. What do we learn from this? Three dead worms in three glasses. Because of alcohol, because of smoking, and because of eating too much chocolate. One little boy raised his hand and said, I guess if you drink alcohol and smoke and eat chocolate, you won't have worms. Well, no, you missed the point. Well, let me tell you, it's going to be easy to miss the point about this sermon. You see, if you focus of the story could easily be the deranged man who's running in the graveyard with chains. But the real focus should be the power of Jesus over spiritual forces. Now, I got to tell you, this story is an incredible story. When you start looking at the characters in it and what's going on, it's almost like a political cartoon. Or it's almost like some kind of a sketch, because what's happening here is a story with a crazed man running through the tombs and a group of soldiers gathering around trying to contain him, and a bunch of Gentiles or Jews that are over here raising a bunch of pigs, and a Jewish rabbi that walks up and shocks them all. Let's take a look at it. The first thing I want you to look at is where he was. He was in the country of the Gadarenes, or the Gerasenes, as it may be stated. This is the Decapolis. This is an area that both of these cities are in. And so while one gospel writer may use Gerasene and another one may need Gadarene, it's the same area. And while they're coming into this area, Jesus knows about these people. You see, these people have a history. These people have a history with God. When the 12 tribes were coming into the promised land, there were two tribes who balked, Reuben and Gad. Reuben and Gad said, you know what? We like it right here. Man, we've got cattle and we've got all this pasture around. Why would we go somewhere else? And Moses said, you won't go fight and win this battle with us? You just want to stay here? And they said, well, no, we'll get some soldiers together, but let us just have this land. Well, that's what they did. These were a people that were really compromised in following the law of God. They knew God, who he was, but as far as being really committed to his plan, they were not like their fellow believers. But here's the point. They're raising pigs. Now, for a Jew, pigs are unclean. Because of the way they eat, because of their digestive system, God had declared them unclean. Now, Peter, later on, after Pentecost, has a vision, and he says, whatever God has made clean, let it be clean. And so he kind of relieved that restriction. But right now, they are violating the very law of God. Not only that, they're raising pigs to sell to Roman soldiers and to the Gentiles. That'd be like somebody in the church having a poppy field and making cocaine and selling it. That'd be like somebody who's selling meth out of their house, and a group of people in the church, you say, well, it's fine for us to do this. We wouldn't tolerate it, and not many people tolerated them. There was the army, the Roman soldiers who were hated by the Gentiles and hated by the Jews. They were hated because they were in control of an occupied territory. They were not people who were received well. And there were possibly a legion, maybe, a legion of Roman soldiers. And then there was a man. And this man is controlled by spiritual darkness. This man has lost control of his own body. He has lost control of his mind. This man is a man who is, what the Bible says, possessed by demons. Now, children and everybody needs to understand this. Satan is not omnipresent like God is. And so Satan, if he's going to have an influence somewhere, must use forces or, quote, demons that they might go into the areas that he wants to control. These demons are looking for a body to inhabit or to influence, something that they can find a place to be on the face of this earth. You'd say, preacher, I don't know that I really believe in demons. Well, let me just say this. Satan doesn't care whether you believe in him or believe in his demons, as long as you're open to let him influence your passions. Your desires and my desires, our drives, the things that Satan wants to get a hold of and distort, are often controlled by spiritual influences. Do you think that influence comes out of the air, or do you think that there's a power behind it? Do you believe that something happened to this man, that he walked into the wrong territory and somehow was taken, or that along the way in his life, he had given his life over to some very strong powers? But here he is, living in a graveyard. This is another place that is inhabited, that's unclean, because God had told the Jews, don't touch dead people and don't stay in their tombs. Stay away from that because of the decay, because of a lot of things. But there was no place else for this guy to live. And so he lived in the tombs. And then there's the rabbi. The rabbi named Jesus, this Jewish teacher that walks into a Gentile area with people going, what in the world are you doing here? When you read this in the Gospel of Luke, it's as if Luke is saying he never should have been there. He was really in the wrong place. He comes in unannounced, but he's very bold in what he has to say. And here's a point. Number one, he's recognized by the demons. He's recognized by the forces that are taking this man down, and they cry out to him and call him the Son of God. I'm going to say this again later. They see him, this power recognizes him as the Son of God. Well, then there's the pigs. So the pigs, the army, the Gentiles, the soldier, and the man. And all of this is happening. It's amazing, too, that whenever these demons speak out or this man speaks out, what the demons say is, you can't touch us right now because it wasn't time. What does that mean? What do you mean you can't throw? Because they knew something that we forget, and that is there is coming an end to all of this world. There is coming an end where they knew that they would be judged and thrown back into the very pit of hell. And they were saying, this is not the time. They acknowledged something that they knew that nobody else could have known. They called him the Son of the Most High God. How did Jesus handle him? He said, well, we don't want to be thrown into that pit of hell. You can't do that, but don't hurt us here. Don't torment us here because you can bring great pain on us. Why don't you just throw us into the hogs? Now, some people say, well, it really wasn't influences, or it really wasn't bad things. The man just had mental illness. Well, how do you put mental illness into a bunch of pigs? How do you put mental illness over into a bunch of swine and cause them to become so deranged they run toward a cliff and slide down the side and go into the water and drown? By the way, I guess that's the first time they made deviled ham. That's where that must have happened. I want to talk to you about something. Spiritual warfare and your life. Spiritual warfare and the Christian. This Gadarene demoniac appears right after Jesus had done a couple of other things. One of the first things he'd done is he had healed some sick in Matthew 8, just in that one chapter. He'd healed one of the people there in the town. And then he had left there, and we'd seen the miracle on the Sea of Galilee where he calmed the storm. And now then he takes this demoniac and delivers him from all of these influence and these demons, and he casts them out. It's not very long after that in the book of Luke that Jesus asks a question. And he looks at his disciples and he says, "Who do people say that I am? And who do you say that I am? After what you've seen, who do you say that I am?" That's the question. That's the question every man must answer. Who do you say that Jesus is? The demons knew the answer. You're the Son of God. These accounts in Matthew 8 are not just about what Jesus did. These accounts are about Jesus' power in this universe, regardless of what area of the universe you want to talk about. His miracles covered all of it. Personal healing, storms. His healings caused spiritual forces to be denied in the life of an individual. The Bible's very clear about this. The Bible says very clearly who Jesus is. In Philippians 2, if you want to look it up, in Philippians 2, there's a statement given that clarifies all of this for us. God bestowed upon him, Jesus, the greatest title that could be given. He highly exalted him and gave him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Who is Jesus? The Son of God. He is Lord. If you look at what Satan can do, you begin to realize that he is the prince of the power of the air. He has a lot of things that he can do with his powers here on this earth. He can influence a lot of things. If you look in the book of Job, God kind of released Job to him. And he said, "You can do with him whatever you can do." He brought a great storm. There was a great storm that came and killed a lot of his family. He brought sickness. Yes, sickness. He brought despair. Satan has a lot of power, but none of them is as ultimately powerful as the power of God. No one has the last word like Jesus does. I know that there are many individuals right now who are really afraid. I know that they have seen the sweeping virus that has come across this planet. And for many of them, they feel that they cannot avoid its power. They cannot avoid its touch. And so they're living in fear. I want you to hear me. Jesus is bigger than all of Satan's schemes and powers. You see, Satan and his crowd were keenly aware in that scene there around the tombstones that they could be destroyed. The Bible says this about Jesus in 1 John 3:8. "For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil." That's our Jesus. That's the miracle worker. That's the one I serve. That's the power that has brought us such strength in our lives and caused us to bring praise to him. Make no mistake, there's a spiritual war going on right now. And it's on the basis of all that's happening in the world. and all that will happen in the world, to deny that that's going on and to separate it from your life is foolishness. You see, there's a spiritual war going on, and man is the battleground. Your life and my life, Satan would love to destroy us. Satan would love to come and use us by bringing us under his control and causing us to affect the lives of others, that our spirit of fear would cause others pain, that our spirit of bitterness would hurt others, that our spirits of addiction and abuse would cause damage, our spirit of hate, our spirit of war. All of those can be something that Satan can use. Paul reminded the people at Corinth of this state by this statement. This is in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. And it's a very important statement. And if you mark your Bible should have this marked. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses. What fortresses? The fortresses of Satan. Ephesians tells us that we're to put on the armor of God, that we are not to try to fight in our own strength. This verse from Corinthians promises that those who find and know how to use God's weapons can throw down things that try to take over their life. I'm not just talking about alcohol. I'm not talking about drugs. I'm talking about fear. I'm talking about hate. I'm talking about bitterness. I'm talking about pride. All of those things that Satan would use to discredit you in the lives of others and destroy the peace that you would desire in your life. You see, tearing down the places in our lives where Satan has control must often be in the same way they were erected, brick by brick, thought by thought. You see, the truth is, you'll never win a spiritual battle with weapons of the flesh. You'll never be able to overcome your weaknesses and overcome those things that are defeating you by using things of the flesh. In Ephesians 6, it says, the weapons for our warfare, listen, the way we fight against these things, the way we fight against Satan, are the Word of God and prayer. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against the powers, against the forces of wickedness in heavenly places. I've been warned not to scare the children with this message, to make them get focused on the fact that there are some forces and there's some demons in the world. But that's why I said at the beginning, get the understanding right. This is not about the power of Satan. This is about the power of Jesus Christ. This is about the authority over the universe and the power of God over it. Let's look at the man who lost control. Let's look at the man who was there in the tombs with an unclean spirit and had his dwelling among the tombs. And the Bible says that he was shackled with chains. They were all around him. He'd been bound with chains. But the strength that he had torn those chains apart, but they were still around him in broken pieces. And nobody could control him. And he was screaming as he ran through the tombs. And he was gashing himself with stones. Let me make something clear. You may think sin's fun to play with, but when sin gets done with you, that's what you look like. It destroys. It kills. Whether it's alcohol or whether it's drug, whether it's money and debt or pride, whatever it might be, the porn, whatever it might be, it begins to take your mind over and then it begins to take over your body. And it leaves you broken and shackled. You don't even want to be what you are. You don't even want to do what you're doing. But you can't stop it. And it's driving you eventually mad. This man had lost all of his identity except for his affliction. How many times have I heard somebody say, that man's an addict? How many times have I heard somebody say, she is filled with the spirit of pride? All of a sudden, people become identified not by their place in Jesus Christ, but by the defeats that have taken over and the weaknesses of their lives. I don't think we want to define our lives by the setbacks and failures we've had. I don't think we want to live in such a way that we don't have the power to be able to engage this world. Truth of the matter is, why is it that every time we want to take a risk and be vulnerable, every time we want to launch out and do something, the legions speak? All of the people seem to speak. All of the legions begin to speak. We often hear a legion of voices trying to discourage us, trying to possess us, trying to defeat us. And they're all fighting against the still, small, powerful voice of God that says, no, you can do this. You can beat this. You can achieve this. The screaming in our head of our weaknesses against the still small voice of God. I want to say something too so that children understand as well as teens and adults. Satan's forces can't just jump on you and change you. It's not like you can be walking along and all of a sudden you're just overcome and now then you're someone that's lost their mind. They have to do it step by step, thought by thought. They can't just come in and take over like that. This man didn't get into this condition overnight. Over in the book of James, in the first chapter, you're going to learn how it happens. But each one is tempted when he's carried away and enticed by his own lust. Then when lust is conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is accomplished, it brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my brethren. Becoming entangled in sin takes time. I think that most all of you out there know someone intimately, know someone that's in your family, know someone that's been a dear friend, and they're just not who they used to be. They are now broken. They are now seemingly hopeless. And the truth is, you love them as much as you can love them. But they had slowly slipped away, and over time, they also ended up in tombs. You see, sin loves a vacuum, like nature abhors a vacuum. And where there's an open place in your heart that's not under the control of God, that's exactly where Satan wants to come in. And it's why we are commanded throughout Scripture, be filled with the Spirit, to walk in the Spirit, and not obey the lusts of the flesh, to walk in the Spirit, to be filled with the Spirit, to force that place out. You may know this. It's amazing how much we tolerate evil, even in our own lives. And we believe that we can control our addictions until we're bound in chains and feel powerless to break free. We use the term spirit of. When I say a spirit of pride, it means that something has taken control. A spirit of bitterness, a spirit of hate, a spirit of pride, money, whatever it is. It's that for the Christian, something that's come into our lives. And then we begin to make excuses. Well, I'm not as bad as other people. Oh, I know I could stop this anytime I wanted to. It's really not hurting me. And besides that, look at all the people around me that are doing the same thing. Because when we get in this trap, we begin to live with people that are just like us. And all of a sudden, as Matthew says, there's two in the graveyard. You see, the world cannot change someone trapped in spiritual bondage. I'm going to say it again. The world cannot change someone trapped in spiritual bondage because control won't change people. I hope you've learned that with your children. You might can control them. That doesn't mean that they've learned anything. They might know to fear you, but have they learned how to love? Have they learned how to share? Have they learned how to control their own emotions? Or are they merely just following the commands of the warden We've used different programs to deal with people that have become under the influence of various substances and various issues in their life. And we've tried all those things to bring them about. But if it's a spiritual battle, there's only one who can win that battle. And that's the miracle worker, Jesus. You see, Jesus is Lord. And whatever negative power that is against you at this present moment, rest assured that it will never sustain itself in the presence of Jesus. Have you tried that? Have you really tried to, instead of just trying to quit or trying to stop or seeking some time, have you really gotten on your face in the Word of God with prayer and said, God, take it away. Before it destroys me, before it destroys my friends, God, please take it away. Now I'm going to lead you to a very, very different verse in regard to this. This passage is over in Hebrews chapter 4. For over in Hebrews chapter 4, you're going to see some words that talk about what it takes to get free. I want to help you know how that you can be free by the power of Jesus over spiritual forces, how you can be free. In Hebrews chapter 4 in verse 12, we discover the power of God's word and his grace. Now you stay with me, because this is so important. For the word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, and piercing as far as the division of soul and spirit, of both joints and marrow, and able to judge the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are open and laid bare to the eyes of him who with whom we have to do. What's that say? It says you can't lie to God. He knows everything about you. That when you open the Word of God and you read the Word of God, all of a sudden you're going, God, that's me. That's really me. I mean, I know I can fool everybody else, but I can't fool you. So what does that mean? He's going to judge you? Does that mean he's going to hurt you? Does that mean he's going to do something in your life to stop? No, not at all. Because if you read on in this passage, the Word of God directs us to someone who understands and has the power to overcome that in our lives. Listen, Hebrews 4:14. Therefore, because God knows us, because we know ourselves, therefore, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in all things as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, let us draw near with confidence to the throne of grace and find mercy and grace to help in time of need. Jesus understands. Jesus has fought this same Satan. He has fought this battle, and he knows something, and you need to know it, and I need to know it, and that is no man can stand against Satan on his own. Every man will fall to one of his schemes, and Jesus knows why. He says, therefore, you come to me, and let me pour out my mercy, I care. And let me give you the grace to be able to overcome. You see, at the end of the day, it doesn't matter what is lined up against us. We are safe in the power that Jesus brings. Did you hear me? Listen, children. Listen, everyone. We are safe in the power that Jesus brings. That spirit of fear, got to ask you, are you okay right now? If you're okay right now and you were okay yesterday, what makes you think you won't be okay tomorrow? Why are you running in a spirit of fear? Why are you bringing things into today? Why do you have that spirit of bitterness that you can't learn to forgive? Why are those things happening? Jesus can overcome every one of them. You know, when Jesus got through with this man, there's a new picture of him that's given in the Gospels. And they said he was sitting in his right mind, fully clothed, and he wanted to go with Jesus. You see, this man was given the fullness of his life back, and Jesus told him to go home. Home? Home for a person who's been so addicted that their life has been stolen? I can still go home? Yes, you can go home. You can find a place that you didn't have before all of this began. You have no need to be afraid of the powers that you don't understand. You have no need to be afraid of the powers that are in control of many, because all of these powers will ultimately fail under the name of Jesus. This spiritual war has been won. Let's close this out. What are the results of this? What are the results of the encounter? Well, the afflicted man received him. The Bible says, now the man out of whom the devils were departed besought him that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away saying, go to your own house and show them what God's done. And he went his way and he told all the people in the city what great things. Jesus turned him into an evangelist. You wait, you got this? Naked man running through the tombs. Evangelist. One who's been broken. One who's been healed. One who has nothing but pain. One who has a story of healing. And they become those who testify of the power of Jesus. What about the town? Well, the town rejected him. The herdsman ran away, went to the city, reported everything, told what happened to the demoniacs, and the whole city came out. When they saw him, they said, would you get out of here? Jesus didn't get a lot of work done in that city. They rejected him. You see, the truth is they were more concerned with property than people. They were just mad, mad, mad because he destroyed their herds of swine. Jesus had done something that I'm sure God wanted done, and that was to stop those people who were violating his law from doing so and causing others to fail as well. And all he did was he said, go, and those swine were gone. But there's one other group, and that's us. Because believers from this story learn the power of Christ over spiritual darkness. James says, or do you think that the scripture speaks for no purpose? He jealously desires the spirit which he has made to dwell in us. He jealously desires the spirit which he has made to dwell in us. But he gives a greater grace. Therefore, the scripture says, God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. And then the verse that you may have been waiting on all this sermon. James says, submit therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he'll draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Find peace in Christ. I pray that if there's been a part of this that you've heard that all of a sudden began to speak to your heart, that right now, where you are, you just bow your head and say, God, I know exactly what it is in my life that's destroying me. And I'm going to ask you by the power of Jesus to begin to work on me step by step, thought by thought, brick by brick, to remove it from my life. Or God, if you choose to just deliver me from this today. God, I pray that everyone who has heard this message might hear it in the spirit with which you wanted it delivered. In Jesus' name, amen. We've got a special treat for you. A previous recording of a song of our choir. I just pray that this will bless you and give you even more encouragement to let Jesus be Lord. God bless you.
Your face.
again for joining us for worship this morning. Remember, you can always reach out to us by phone, social media, website, and don't forget to visit our online giving page to support all the ministries of our church, including the one that brought you this broadcast. Thanks again. Have a great day.